Thank you for having invited me to this great meeting. I thank Cristiano, Cristina, and Max, and the whole committee for inviting me. I feel very privileged to be here. From the different presentations that were made so far, it's directly in line with what I'm going to say. A lot of things were already said that I'm going to describe. So I'll present first, I think it's the most efficient way, we say in French, une image vaut mille mots. We'll have a short video. There might be a little story about that that I'll tell you afterwards of how that video happened. But let's watch it first, and then I'll have a little PowerPoint just of visual support, but I'm going to talk about my experience with Grégoire Aungbonon. I learned to pronounce his name.
November 18th, 2012, Cotonou, Benin, West Africa. Grégoire and I were driving home on the expressway when suddenly he sees, 50 meters away on his far right, a person I hadn't seen, a person lying on the sidewalk just in front of the store. So we turned back and headed for that spot, and what we came upon is a sight that's been haunting me since. Catholic, originally from Benin, Grégoire left school early and in search of adventure settled in Bouaké, Côte d'Ivoire in 1971. Within 5 years he became prosperous, repairing tires and running taxis. However, in 1980 he went through such financial problems he got close to committing suicide. With counseling from a priest, he emerged from this depression craving for the scriptures. What stone can I bring to building the church? Was the question he'd constantly entertained in his heart. Back from his pilgrimage to Jerusalem, Grégoire set up a prayer group who visited and fed the sick, the lepers, and the prisoners. One day, stumbling upon one of those mentally ill people are so afraid of, walking about naked in the city and picking garbage cans, it suddenly dawned on him that that man and all of them deserve to be treated with utter dignity, as they are the neighbor Jesus referred to, Grégoire realized. Grégoire started visiting the homeless every night, his wife preparing water and food for them. But deciding this was still not enough, he set up a refuge in the back of the Bouaké hospital, where he started treating them with the help of psychiatrists. The word spread, his work got known, and he repeatedly got called for help in the surrounding villages. One of the worst days of my whole life, says Grégoire, was when one day I came to a village where a father forbid me to help his own son, whom he said was rotting away anyway. Outraged, I threatened to call the police, and I was let in. I'll never forget what I saw, never. Tied to the floor with barbed wires plowing through his flesh, I did eventually succeed in cutting away at them and brought him to the refuge, where at least he died in dignity. From then on, week after week, since the last 20 years, Grégoire discovered with sheer horror how families, helpless, dealt with their mentally ill in the villages. Chained or blocked in wooden beams, they were kept for 5, 10, 30 years, oftentimes in the bush, in the sun, and in the rain. Faithful to the founder's wish to get ever closer to all those who are fragile, Saint Camille Association built one residential center after another to meet the growing needs, such that 20 years later there are now 4 such inpatient centers in Côte d'Ivoire and a 4th one nearing completion in Benin. There are 200 inpatients at any one moment in each of those centers, all of them staffed mainly by patients that have been successfully stabilized, of which some have become nursing aides, while others, having had their nursing curriculum paid by Saint-Camille, became certified nurses. One such remarkable patient got to be director of one of Saint Camille's residential centers for 3 years, as well as being its head nurse. In order to best ensure long-term compliance, Grégoire developed relay centers, that is, mental health dispensaries run by nun-nurses from the various religious communities that are present in most of rural Benin. Supervised by psychiatrists from Europe and Canada, a mobile nursing team provides the medication and the expertise for assessing more difficult cases, some of whom may need to be hospitalized. As the mentally ill are far from welcomed in the public system, Saint-Camille has built its own general hospitals for its own patients, which also serves the local population. As Saint-Camille gets no subsidies whatsoever, a minimal financial contribution is welcomed, except for those who cannot afford, for whom care is free. Patients are trained into social skills and taught a trade, so as to help them acquire some economic self-sufficiency. Over the last 20 years, around 60,000 patients have been brought back to their families, a lot of them earning a living and founding their own family. Educating families about mental illness is done at Saint-Camille since the 1990s. They are taught there is absolutely no witchery involved in mental illness, nor are those patients contagious. They are also told to support their ill parent, encouraging them to comply to their often lifelong medication. A home support team, as well as self-help groups of parents, are planned to take effect as soon as 2015. Now here we see Amadou, a young man chained for 7 years before he got freed by Grégoire many years ago. He works as an assistant now for the radiology department at Bouaké Saint-Camille General Hospital. And now this is Janvier, chained like no animal would ever be. This man has now become the pride of his village, as he provides palm oil through operating a machine Saint-Camille bought for him. He now has a wife and children.
Non seulement on m'a enchaîné, on ne me donnait pas à manger. Je ne buvais pas. J'ai un devoir. Étant malade et qu'on m'a aidé à me retrouver, moi aussi me dois de les aider. C'est-à-dire aider les malades à se retrouver.
All this being said, a lot of work lies ahead, and Grégoire knows it very well. As people come to know about Saint-Camille, some inhuman situations get more and more brought to Saint-Camille's attention. This is the case of prayer camps in Togo. Grégoire has been fighting for years now the maltreatment patients in those sects are victim of. Families bring their mentally ill in hundreds of privately owned prayer camps, believing the miracle cure. So-called prophets or Pentecostal or evangelical religious leaders promise in return for a generous financial contribution. In fact, patients are forced to urinate, bathe, sleep, and defecate in the spot where they are chained, as Mrs. Shanta Bariga has rightly denounced as part of the 2012 Human Rights Watch report on prayer camps in Ghana. La vie est finie, claimed this patient. Just imagine yourself chained until the prophet says you're well enough to be freed. Wouldn't you also think life is over with? For Mariam, though, whom Grégoire saved from death on that famous sidewalk in Cotonou, life is just beginning again. Mother of six, now working at one of Saint-Camille's residential centers as a cook, given back her dignity, we brought her back to her own family. Again, the same mixed feelings. Her brother is crying from joy and also from shame he did not try harder to get her back. But above all, it is the fear he would be caught having to care for her. Would she relapse? Fear having a witch in their midst again. Relentless, Grégoire keeps on answering cries for help, offering solutions and opening centers, giving conferences in Africa, in Europe, in America, to priests, students, health professionals, and administrators of all sorts to help curb stigma. Nous devons changer notre regard, Grégoire keeps saying everywhere. We must change the way we look at people who are fragile, because all this is about humanity.
those are hard pictures to see, but this is, I always think that truth is reality, bare reality. And we have to be, you know, with reality if we want to help and if we want to be human. There are hard things, but there are very nice things. One of the nice pictures I saw in the movie is, it's a short, we see it very shortly, but you see a number of patients aligned, they're all in a line, and you see that bright face there. So amidst all of this, there are people that are joking, that are, you know, a lot of laughs in Africa. I go to Africa not for safaris. I don't like safaris. I like, you know, animals, okay, but it's not my thing. I like smiles, and I like, there's a lot of humanness, that people that are there in Africa, I go for the people. There are no cathedrals, this is not like Europe, but you go for the heart. Africa is the beat of the heart. So anyways, I will tell you a little bit about what brought me there. I think I have to start saying that I had a dream, in a sense. When I was a teenager, I wanted to be, I read two books. One was Charles de Foucault. He's in the late 19th century, early 20th century. He's a man, he's a French man from Alsace, Strasbourg, and he was an aristocrat and hedonistic, and he had a turnover, a conversion, if you want. And he decided to become a monk. And he went to the desert. And he lived in the desert for many years. And he wanted to found an order, a Catholic order of monks. He never succeeded. He had only one member. But after his death, it's like often in life, you know, if you want a tree, something has to die so that something will grow afterwards. And that's what happened. Many people now are, Charles de Foucault, I think, is not a saint yet, but he's on his way, in the process. Anyways, that was one of my inspirations. The other inspiration was Albert Schweitzer, another Frenchman, again from Alsace. I have a special tie with Alsace. I went to my fourth and fifth grade in primary school, grade school there, as my father was doing his doctorate. In French literature in Strasbourg. So Schweitzer, a great musician, Bach, a theologian, and a doctor who set up a clinic in Gabon, Lambaréné. I never went there, but I have a friend, so she'll probably connect me with someone down there eventually. And as far as the desert is concerned, I'll go to South Moroccan desert as soon as I... So on Halloween Day, I'm leaving for Benin again. I go once a year, and I'll spend 3 weeks with Grégoire again, as I've done since 2011. I'll tell you why I'm going back. It's not because I didn't understand. I after those 3 weeks, I'll go to the desert in South Morocco. And I've always had a particular, always been attracted by the desert, Sahara Desert. So that was my dream, but instead of becoming a missionary, I became a psychiatrist. I don't know if there's a link, but anyways. In a sense, there is, because there are a lot of Ami community psychiatrists, which is a rare species in Quebec. Psychiatrists for about, I don't know, 95, 97, 98% are in the hospitals. But I work in the community, GP clinics and family physician clinics, and that's what I like. That's what I like doing. So in a sense, there is this kind of missionary there, but you know, I wanted the real thing, to go to Africa. And so at one point I said, look, speaking to whatever, if we may say, I said, look, when you're decided, you tell me. But I haven't given up the idea, but I said, well, okay, I'm not in control, so whenever that comes up. And it did come up, to my big surprise. I was 51 a number of years ago. And I was supposed to go to court for an insurance problem. Insurance like to collect money, but they don't like to give the money again, you know. And that's how they make big buildings. Anyways, I had met that the psychiatrist for the insurance. He wouldn't like saying that he's working for the insurance, but anyways, he's paid by them. This psychiatrist called sick the day before we were supposed to go to court, and I had canceled my day at the clinic. Usually, when that happens, I would have put my patients back. I said, well, I'll stay home. Why not? And I didn't like listening to radio or TV at that time, and I decided, I don't know why, I just decided to let it on, leave the radio on. It was 9 o'clock, 10 after 9 in the morning. And in Montreal, there was at that time, there was, radio shows on all kinds of topics, and all of a sudden I hear Benin, Grégoire, working with people that are chained up, as you saw, in the countryside and all this, and he's taking care of them. And I told my wife, well, I put the volume on, you know, I want to put it up, I want to hear some more. And so I couldn't spell, I couldn't understand his last name, I understand you. That's a long name. The nice thing is, in the interview, it was like about 30 minute interview. At the end, he said that he was gonna give a conference about 20 minutes from where I live. So I decided right away to, you know, make place for that the day after. So it was a Thursday, so I called my secretaries and, and I decided to go. So I'm a little bit shy, so I stood at the back, and I said, well, you know, if I don't like that, I'll just go away, that's it. And it was the last speaker was finished, and there was a break, and that break time they had these arts craft from Africa, which I crave. So I went to see these things, and I wanted to buy something, and one of the ladies there, volunteers, said to me, well, what are you doing here? Do you work here? It was Louis H. Lafontaine, l'Institut de Santé Mentale de Montréal. It's long names now. They make them longer and longer every time. And I said, yeah, I'm just a psychiatrist. I just came to see and hear this man, you know. Oh, you're a psychiatrist. Do you want to speak to Grégoire? I said, no, I don't want to disturb him. It's okay. And she told another man, and he was kind of tall and big, and he said, no, you're coming. And I had like no choice. He just took me by the, you know, sleeve, and he dragged me right until I got face to face with this little man. He's about my height, just a little bit shorter, and he was smiling, but not, it's a true, honest smile. You know these people that smile from the heart, not from the muscles? And that's what it was. And so that's where it started, and he invited me to Africa, and I said, well, I'll have to talk to my wife first. And so a year later, I went. It was the first time, and it's interesting, Montreal, Paris is 6 hours. Paris to Cotonou in Benin is 6 hours, and you just cross the Sahara Desert, and you see like the Mediterranean Sea, so a blue space, and then you see this yellowish space longer, you know, underneath the plane, and it's really fascinating to see that. And so I stayed 4 weeks the first time, and he said, well, you want to see Africa? Come and see. And we toured four or five countries the first time around, and sleeping in the car, sleeping in not hotels. We go to either religious places, like nuns or because this is a Catholic organization, the NGO, the Saint Camille de l'Élysée. So, but there's no luxury there, you know. At one point, we were sleeping in the car, and we hadn't eaten since the breakfast. So no food during the whole day, and at the end of the, it was about 10 o'clock in the evening, and he said, are you hungry? I said, kind of. So, so we went to pick up something not far from there, and then we just slept in the car. I was there in the November 2016 election, and I think I was, anyways, I was in the car, and he was snoring, and his son was there too, and they were both snoring, so I just let the radio on, and I heard what was going on then. Okay. So that's how I met the man, and he had me tour the different, Oh, yeah, sorry. It's a little bit late. I have no financial conflict of interest. So those are the ones. It's interesting. The that portrait of Albert Schweitzer on the on your left is I had drawn that picture when I was well in Ontario. It was grade 13, so I was 17 or 18 years old, and I had decided to go in history or law, and I did not finish this. I had finished reading one of the books. I think it was the book on Albert Schweitzer, and I decided to stop. It was at mid October, and I decided to stop and take the prerequisite to go in medicine at medical school. After having drawn his picture. This is on your right, Charles de Foucault. Again, we see, look at the eyes. Those don't lie, as the last speaker said. The soul, yeah. Sorry, I forgot your name. Karen? Karen. The eyes don't lie. And when we saw Piccinini's face, that doesn't lie either. This is Grégoire, and this is me in Paris in, I think, I don't know, 2013, something like that. First contact with Africa. As I said, smiles. You have these in Benin, you have those children that when they see white people, they have different reactions. Those ones are smiling. The little ones, the small babies, start to cry because they're really afraid. What is that? So I had a couple of weird reactions, but I can understand where that comes from. But people are smiling. They're not, you know, there's no luxury. They live in the villages, but they have their cell phones, though. All of them have their cell phones. That's kind of strange. Again, you see that lady with the bananas on her head. I've seen big, you know, these big bottles. I think it was like 8 or 9 of them. I don't know how they can, but they're really straight and they stand up. It's great. It's nice to see, and the ladies are very dignified, and the way they walk, it's beautiful. Yeah, the day we saw 95 patients, at one point he brought me to one of those dispensaries. So There are what he's set up, basically I'll talk about in a few minutes, but he's set up a whole system. But what's important is the system, but the history is important behind it, because it tells what animates the man. But yes, 95 patients in one day, which obviously would probably amaze a lot of doctors, bring a lot of money here, but down there it's, you know, these people, they were coming to see the doctor, psychiatrist, they don't know what it is, so they come and see the doctor, and one of them, I didn't put the picture in there, but one of them came. And they come with the whole family. The person that was talking about in Africa, it's fascinating. The whole family comes, and you have the whole family come in, and you have the other family in the same room, and they're listening. And some, you know, they throw jokes here and there, and the confidentiality is not the same as here, you know, really not. It's fascinating to see that. It's really nice, So on that day, it was 9 o'clock in the evening. We had started at 7:30 or 8 in the morning, and it was 9 o'clock. We were still seeing patients, and that lady came in with a child, a toddler, a baby, I would say, probably about 8-9 months, and he had a big burn, and I was looking at the baby, but they were not coming for the baby. He just happened to be holding the baby. He was coming for the mother. She was schizophrenic. And, you know, so it's something else. And he said, we cannot turn them away. They came miles and miles. You know, they come from maybe 50 miles, 100 miles, and you cannot send them back. You have to see them all. Okay. I just have to ask the questions, though, you know. Let me time to ask the questions, because the thing is, they all speak different dialects. So I have to, you know, so oftentimes the family will, you know, one member will try to translate, and it's no problem. Everybody does that. They have 60 languages in Benin, just that small country, 60 languages. So they're used to it, and they translate. And in the midst of interpretations about witchery and all this, you know, mental illness is a big. They don't know about mental illness. All they know is the person was okay, and all of a sudden turns bizarre, starts to hear voices, starts to speak, and they interpret usually that the person has been somebody cast a spell on her or on him, and then they have to go through rituals, and you know. So that's the way people think, and we won't change. Necessarily, one of the Grégoire's main points is that we will not change by argumenting, we will change by having results, and that's the way we change people's mentality, by having results, by, you know, getting things done, and then when people see that things get better, as we said before, I heard, what do people want? I want to be cared for. And oftentimes, when I ask a patient, what do you want? Je veux revenir comme avant. I want to be back as I was. Now, they'll never be back as they were, but not in the same sense. Life is therapy, as we say. But, okay. This is Ganvier. That's a water city near Cotonou. I went there. I don't do a lot of tourism. I do very little tourism when I go there. As Grégoire told me recently again, tu vas avoir du boulot, you'll have to work. I know. He doesn't have to tell me, but he still does. So Saint-Camille Mental Health System, this is one of the centers, and it's very, now we don't see here, but you see goats go around, and you know, like if we apply the same standards here, and some people that because a lot of people from abroad come to Saint-Camille, so you know, if you come with your American mind, North American mind, or your European Western mind, you cannot understand. It's like anything. If you want to understand something, you have to. I went to a mind body conference in Boston. I just came back from that in the last few days. And one of the one of them was saying there's an Indian proverb saying that if you want to know someone, walk in his shoes for 5 days or whatever. Well, that's what it is. You know, you have to put yourself in someone's shoes. So, Saint Camille. First of all, the name Saint Camille is a feminine name, but it's also a masculine name. Originally in French, Camille, Camillo. He's an Italian. He comes from southern Italy. I can't remember the name exactly where the city. It's a small village, and he was in the 16th century. Across the 16th and 1500 to 1600, something like that. And he was a soldier, and he had a mishap, he had problems, he got handicapped, and he became a priest, and he became eventually a saint. He opened a hospital, and he said, we're going to treat people not like animals, but like humans. And he insisted on that. He became, Saint Camille is the patron of all caretakers. So 1983, as we saw in the video, in 1983, Grégoire, after having gone through bankruptcy, he had not a depression. Some people talk about a depression, but he was discouraged, and he wanted to do away with himself. And something happened, and in other words, he tried to take pills, and it just didn't work. And he had a first insight. And one of his first insight was that this life is not your own life. This life is not for you. This life is to be used, is to be, you know, this is a gift. And so the next question was, well, what do I do with that gift? What is it for? And so in his journey, he learned lessons. That's the first one. Life is therapy. He learned that, you know, this life is not for you. You need to give it away. You need to use it. And then he learned that you need to use it for someone else. He went to, when I talk about the pilgrimage in Jerusalem, there's a priest that paid, he had no money at that point, and a priest paid his plane ticket to go to Jerusalem. And say he went to the holy city. And he had another insight that, well, this life is to be used for others. Seems simple, but humanity is about simple things. It's just integrating them, making them in your life. And so he went there, and then he came back, 1983, gathered 8 people around him, Christians. Because Bouaké, he lived in Bouaké, in the north of Côte d'Ivoire, Ivory Coast. And people live, you know, together. They are Muslims, and they're Catholics and Protestants and all kinds of different religions. And okay, so over 25 years after he founded his NGO in 1983, we need to know that between 1983 and 1990, when he started to tend mental health patients, he tended, he helped hospitalized patients in Africa do not get care. If you have no money, you don't get care. If you have that, there's this young man who had an accident, and he lied unconscious in his car, and the police went by, just looked, and they went away. because he appeared dead. There, a passerby got closer, and he said that he saw that this man was still living. He brought him to the hospital. At the hospital, they checked his pockets. He had enough money. He had a pelvic fracture, and he had an ankle fracture. He had enough money for the ankle, so they did the ankle. They didn't do the pelvis. No money for the pelvis. Anyways, so in 1990, 7 years into his NGO, he had helped lepers, AIDS patients, children in the street. And when he started to tend to care for mentally ill patients, people around him said, "You're crazy. I mean, you don't know anything about that. What are you going to do? You're not a psychiatrist. You just repair tires." He says, "We have to help those people." Instead of thinking that they were that they had caste spelled on them, he realized that they were not well, that's all, and maybe they could get help from a psychiatrist, from doctors. And then he set up his own centers because he saw that the psychiatrist, all they were doing is giving medication. And he says, no, medication is essential, but it's not enough, far from enough. And over the years, what he's been doing basically is he's been picking people from the streets and from the villages. In the villages, they tie them up because they don't know what to do. They're not cruel, they just don't know what to do. Actually, if they tie them up, it's just they don't want them to be going anywhere in the streets and going in the jungle and, you know. Now, he set up 12 inpatient centers. In each inpatient centers, so people are hospitalized, there are 200 patients. So you just, and it's over a number of countries. Côte d'Ivoire, 2004, Benin, Togo, 2015, and there's one center in Burkina Faso. He was hospitalizing these people, but they were coming from far. And he said, no, we need to get the care towards the people, not have the, like in our system, the patients have to come to us. In Africa, at Saint-Camille, it's the opposite. The caretakers go towards the patient and the families. Otherwise, if you don't do that, they don't have the money to pay, you know, the transport. They don't have the money to pay the medication. So what do? It's a vicious circle. So you have to stop, you have to interrupt that somewhere. So he thought, well, we need honest people, and how could we, because there's a lot of corruption. Whereas there's misery, there's obviously corruption. So he said, okay, how could we do it? He asked nuns, because nuns, a lot of them, congregations, have a lot of nurses. And they have this dispensaries where they do physical health management. And he said, well, we'll train you and to give psych medication and to make an assessment. And so now he's got 45 mental health dispensaries over the three countries. And then after that, he realized that these patients, want to be loved and want to love. What they need is to feel useful. Even dogs, you know, like if we look at mammals, other mammals, when we have a dog, and at some point I was reading on dogs, and they said if your dog doesn't have anything to do, if it doesn't feel useful, it's gonna like depress. It's gonna, you know, so all the more for human beings. So these people have qualities. They have strengths, and you have to elicit these strengths. And the other thing is he built 2 ambulatory general hospitals. Why? Because doctors don't want to care for those mental ill patients because they're afraid. Thinking about witchery, it's not only the uneducated. I met OBGYN in Benin, and she was saying, and she had studied abroad, and she said, no, when it comes to this, when it comes to mental illness, what she learned that, you know, is called mental illness, we take no chance. The family cannot afford having a witch around or having that bad person casting spells here and there. We really have to defend the family against that. And she was serious. This is no, like, we kind of laugh at this. But there's, in Africa, it's, people won't talk about it unless you really go into, you know, but this is serious matter there. So they don't even care for them if they're too afraid, that's all. It's fear. Fear is a solvent, you know, of humanity. So this is a brief, so as I said, there are many dispensaries, and so there's, so the whole system is there. But what I say, what I'm saying is, the history of how it was built is this. He saw the needs and he answered the needs. He responded to the needs as they presented to him. He's not an expert in mental health management. He's never studied. This man, Grégoire, went to grade six. That's it, grade school. He's very intelligent. It doesn't have anything to do with that. He just, age 14, 13, 14, decided to stop. He wanted to do like his father, be a farmer and be a merchant. I'll have to skip over, but just to give you an idea, 12,000 patients were taken charge of, but that's only two out of the four countries, so you have to double that. 150,000 consultations per year. We have a lot of psychiatrists from France, Quebec, and Spain, and we have one famous psychiatrist from Italy, Marco Bertoli from Friuli, who could be seen in one of these. He's very, that man is alive, I can tell you. This is life in a centre d'accueil, so those are the residential centres, the inpatient centres. People cook, you know, the women, they cook. And it's a time for sharing, you know, your heart and what's going on and all this. It's therapy. This is patience. Music is very important, as I said, the beat of the heart. Learning how to make beds, and so they wait for the medication there. A life given to the most fragile. That's Grégoire in the center there. And this is the lady we saw on the white sidewalk. Now she died. She died probably from a heart attack, from cardiovascular event, probably like that. Suddenly, in Africa, there's no such thing as a yearly exam. You don't have any exams, you just die. And probably if there's an old lady around, that old lady will be interpreted as a witch, unfortunately. If there's a baby who dies in the village, and there's an old lady, the old lady will be accused of having cast a spell. And she will be ousted from the village. Saint-Camille's mission, to give back all persons their dignity, whatever they've done. Whoever they are, whatever they've done. I mean, there is a patient who killed, and now he's building centers in Saint-Camille. Human person is sacred. Now this, as we were talking about before, listening with the heart. Look at that face. I wanted to make, I took the photograph, I wanted to make, you know, zoom on it, but I'm not very high tech, so I didn't succeed in doing that. But I guess you get the gist of it. I'm almost finished. Given, you shall receive. Again, I think pictures speak for themselves, you know. You know, when you were saying before, one of the, Ms. Levac was talking about being called Mama and Papa. I'm called Papa down there, you know. So if I look older, so it just tells, you know. But the way they relate is, you know, like, it's not mama and papa as we, daddy and mommy as we say it here. It's just, as you rightly said, it's just that you're older and they pay respect to you and you're like a fatherly figure or motherly figure. You're a benevolent figure for them. And it's a good sign if you're called papa and mama. Maybe I'll finish with, Yeah, this just says that there's no administrative cost. When I go there, I'm going, as I said, on Halloween next week. I pay my plane ticket. I pay my pension, you know, like this where I stay. And so there's no administrative costs at Saint-Camille. It's been like that for 25 years. It's number one buyer of psychotropic medication in West Africa, $6,000 per year. No funding, absolutely no funding, except none for the government. We just get money from people who watched the conference or heard about him and gave money voluntarily. That's all. That's all. So this man is, you know, trust is a big thing for him. No risk, no evolution. Risk, trust is, you have to take the risk of trusting the patient. We overprotect our patients in mental health oftentimes, especially the psychotic patients, but not only the psychotic patients. We put, and there are a number of examples. One example I'll give is this chauffeur, this guy who is a driver, you know, chauffeur. And he got sick, he got treated, he got better. But then the other caretakers were saying, well, he can't drive again, never again in his life. Okay, well, I said, why? This guy has his judgment back. He has, you know, all his perceptions are okay, all his motor skills are okay, everything's fine. Why would you not get him back to what his life? His life is to drive. Let's give him a second chance. And so the guy, you know, started to drive. And on and on. At one point, he had an accident with a mental health manager who was high in the government. And that guy came to Grégoire and said, are you crazy? I mean, this. Why would you leave a person, a crazy person, drive? And Grégoire told him, he said, first of all, sir, don't call him crazy. He had a mental illness. He got treated. He's on medication, just as a diabetic patient has his in, and he's fine now. And the other thing is, Grégoire went on to ask him, had you never had an accident, sir, before? Concluding that trust does not fear. Fear is our enemy. It's a great enemy. Risk has a cost. This is a, I took that picture as well. He had two phones. And he was, this man is incredible. We were talking about Piccinini, and the same kind of, I really listened well to that Piccinini video, and it really struck me, you were saying, Dr. Beauchamp, that Piccinini had a lot of energy, but he had a balanced life. So in terms of psychiatry, it's not like, it's not an illness. I can vouch for that. It's not an illness. This energy comes from when you, just think, if let's say 30% of your life you're afraid, that much energy, you use 30% of your energy to calm your fear. If you don't fear, if there's, Grégoire is not a man who's afraid. Piccinini is not a man who's afraid. If you're not afraid, this 30% of energy, you just put your heart, you know, when he says put your heart to your life, be in life 100%, that's what it is, you know? So fear holds us back. Ludwig Binswanger was saying from Jerome Frank's book, the therapist should be willing to risk committing his own existence in the struggle of the freedom of his partners. It makes us vulnerable if we take risks. I take the risk, you know, I listen to what Dr. Beauchamp was saying, what others were saying. We need to take risks sometimes. There are risky situations. Le Collège des Médecins is watching, you know, the police is watching. But at the same time, we have an unusual situation. If you don't go ahead and treat the patient, nothing will be done or nothing. You know, it won't get the job done. You have to treat a patient. So you have to take risks. And basically, your reputation is at stake. Your advancement may be at stake. Going before the Collège des médecins, maybe at stake, which is the doctor, you know, the authority, the police, the doctor police. They're watching, they're there, and so, but even though it has a cost, I think it's worth it. That's it.